Sorry, we had some chatting.
Yeah, no, that's cool. But, so, for everybody here, I mean, clearly Nightmare on Elm Street has endured with fans because I think this might be the biggest room of people I've ever had to talk to, so I'm totally not nervous. But I would love to talk to, in terms of sort of, with Lisa and Danny, because one of the cool things I think about Dream Master and Dream Child is that it was such a continuation of that story directly. Did you guys know initially, once Dream Master had wrapped, that you guys were going to come back for this type of story, or did it just kind of come out of the blue at you guys?
Came out of the blue. We didn't know. Because I think the Nightmare 4 story was so well embraced, and relationships and whatnot in Nightmare 4, it was kind of like, I think, a no-brainer for them to do 5 and to, continue
our love story. I was such a big deal at the time, they wanted to put me in another movie, so. I was like, of course.
Yes.
We had no idea. I think we wrote the script, didn't we? I don't know. We're making it up. I'm just kidding. But well, we didn't know.
Well, you took the part because you got to make love to me.
That was it. That was a clincher. I did it for free. I didn't even make any money on that movie. I was the first. And then, besides being the best death scene ever, I was the first non-black dude to get killed in a war from a good. First one killed.
Kelly, for you,
because
I know you've been so involved in a lot of
different West Coast movies, I'm guessing
you were aware of Nightmare.
But how fun was it for you to come into
Dream Child?
Can't you guys wait for the VIP party? Like, I'm waiting for the VIP party.
If a young Tim Burton and Brian Usick got together, it made a really weird Nightmare movie. That's how I would describe Dream Child. It had a great scene.
Not everybody does it for free.
Yes, I did. And I do know how to swim. You know what? I had done Nightmare on Elm Street first, and then I did People Under the Stairs after that, and had a chance to work with Wes as a director. But it was really funny. I wasn't even going to do the movie, because I knew Freddy was big, but I'm like, what is this? But I'm so glad that I did. I didn't know we'd be here 20-something years later talking to people about Nightmare on Elm Street. I am honored to have worked with these people. They're still my friends today. And that's the lovely part of the whole thing. You really make these relationships, and it's great.
Now, Ricky, I've heard Robert say repeatedly over the years that your death is his favorite that he got to do. How cool is that for you? Because he's had a lot of really good deaths over the years. And is that kind of humbling in a way?
Yeah, I got good, that's for sure. I'd like to live just a couple of times by now. Yeah, I got to be honest, man. That was like when Robert did say that. We travel a lot, all of us. And Robert had always said that to me. And he said that the reason it was that way is because, of course, Freddie going to go after a handicap was at Christmas, and just for him, like the best thing that could ever happen. And it's the best thing for me too. I think like Kelly said, to have you guys after all these years to really appreciate what we did in that day. I still wake up and just go, are you kidding? This is my life. This is what I get to do. I'm grateful. And I'm grateful for all you guys to come and give us
likewise.
What you do.
Definitely.
Yes. Totally.
Joanne, you've had the pleasure of being a Nightmare, but you've also worked with some of the Nightmare gals outside of it, and just the 10 of us.
Yes.
But I know with Nightmare 2, there was a big pressure because the first one sort of came out of nowhere. And then it was really quick that how they put it together. Was there an awareness on your part of what Nightmare was at that point?
Oh yeah, Nightmare 1 was huge. I knew that. And how I got Robert Englund actually got me my part. I was in this little Equity Waiver play in Los Angeles, playing a dead girl, and Lynn Shay was...
I know that.
The play was called Ghost. It was just all of us in the dark, and they shut off the lights, and we went around and scared people, right? And Lynn Shay was in the play with me. So Robert came with her brother, Robert Shay, to see the play.
Owner of Blue Line.
Yeah, owner of Blue Line. And after the play, I was introduced to them, and then Robert Englund said to Robert Shay, oh, Joe would be really good as one of the cheerleaders in the bus. He said, what are you doing next weekend? And I said, well, nothing. And he asked me if I had an agent, and I did. So I never got a script, right? I just kind of drove out to Fontana and parked my car and got into a van, and I hope it's the best.
Freddie was driving and you're like, oh, this was a bad decision.
And she was wondering what the rope and electrical tape was doing in the band.
Yeah, exactly. And I thought, I never read the script, I knew anything about it, and I was just kind of making fun of the kid in the back of the bus, and I thought Mark Patton was an extra, because he didn't have any lines, and he was really shy. So, yeah, and then at the movie premiere, we're like, wow, he has a really good part, that extra.
I think you're over this baby, how good it is.
Let's introduce him, the one, the only, Robert Englund, everybody. Robert,
can you hear me? Can you guys hear me? Can you see Tuesday? Can you see up Lisa's dress? Okay. I don't want to lie. Nightmare on Elm Street 4 is not my favorite Nightmare on Elm Street franchise movie. But!
Me neither.
But! It's my favorite performance of myself as Freddy. It's the debut of the beautiful Lisa Wilcox as Alice in Nightmareland. It also includes my favorite sequence of any of the Nightmare films with Danny and with Lisa, where they try to leave the cafe, the craving, get it? Nudge, nudge, wink, wink. When they try to leave it, and it becomes a roundabout. It becomes this recurring, rotating nightmare. This loop, this continuous loop that doesn't end, which is really, truly close to an actual nightmare. And I think it's probably the best depiction of a nightmare in the history of film. Rennie Harlan, who directed this film, went on to Die Hard 2 and hired me to bail him out on a film that's now become a cult classic called The Adventures of Ford Fairlane. I replaced Billy Idol, who brought the Harley Davidson in Laurel Canyon, and because I'd been drinking too much at a roadie bar populated by bricks that got left behind in L.A. since the 1960s, I kind of understood the character. Anyway, I'm gonna turn this over to Lisa, and we're all gonna like remember some events during the filming of this. But I just want to say that this movie, when it first came out, the critics were a little bit glib, and they called it the MTV Nightmare film. But that was because Rennie was using the new editing techniques at that time, which had been discovered on music videos, where they cut to the beat, and cut to the beat. This had been established years before in a film directed by Bob Foster, starring Jessica Lange, and starring Roy Scheider from Jaws as Bob Foster. And in that film, there's a sequence. It's a commercial for airline flight. It's the first time they ever cut to the beat in the history of film. Before that, it was those wonderful masters with Gene Kelly and Fred Astaire in choreography. And this is why a lot of the videos today, you can't really tell anybody can answer.
We're going to that Mexican place after this, after the Q&A.
And this became MTV.
We haven't ate yet. We had breakfast this morning, but we've been gathering Q&As and I was doing the movie thing. By the end of the day, we're like, we haven't ate yet.
So it should be a good party. Rennie's a really gifted actor. Everybody has a story about Rennie. And I'm going to stop laughing and give the microphone now to her debut film in Nightmare on Elm Street, Ms. Lisa Wilcox.